All right, my name is Rich Schmidt. We're here with Jill Czarnowitz and Mark Huff. It's August 26, 2022. We're at Stag Hollow in Yamhill. Thank you both so much for joining us today. And the first question to get things rolling is, why wine?
Why wine?
Why wine?
Yeah.
Well, I'll start. I grew up, my parents drank wine. And I grew up in San Diego. And they would go down to, when I was a teenager, to a tasting room, I guess it was, called Brookside. I think they're still around. And buy their cheap wine. And then I'll just skip ahead. I wound up in Seattle at the University of Washington doing my master's, and I met Mark, and he was making beer at the time, homemaking beer, and I had wine, and he drank the wine, and he decided that it was better for him than beer, and so being a scientist, then he wanted to start making wine eventually, but that's how we got originally into wine. And I think that anything you want to add on that?
Sure, why not?
Of course.
Well, actually, the simple answer, without a lot of stories, would be just shared passions with wine and enjoying food, enjoying the good life. But that probably doesn't make as good a story as you and I meeting and telling the details, does it? So, it was kind of an interesting journey. Where we got started with wine, let me go back to Jill mentioned her family. I'll mention my family. My family was from the East Coast and grew up in the Hudson Valley. And at that time, really the only grape or winemaking region was in the Finger Lakes. And the Finger Lakes at that time was focused on Concord grapes, just wretched sweet wines made by Manischewitz, or at least popularized by Manischewitz, enough to scare anybody away from wine in their youth or even adult life. And so they were more likely to have a gin and tonic with dinner than wine, whereas with Jill, she grew up in California, where wine was readily accessible, part of the culture. And so it was sort of Jill bringing me into her family traditions than me really bringing anything to the table in the wine den. But it certainly was a light bulb moment when we started enjoying wines together. It was like, I never looked back on making beer again. It was just and the funniest part of the story is that that wine, the beer, actually didn't really agree with me, but I didn't really understand it until I was in my 40 plus years later that I'm gluten sensitive, and beer actually ended up kind of sort of pushed me in the direction of really enjoying wine a lot more. And we went through many, many years at the University of Washington just enjoying wine, food together, and we had some access to just some remarkable, remarkable wines back then. Especially, we really loved Italian wines, and we had access to, especially Piedmont wines. There was a wine place that just had these amazing Piedmont wines, dating back 15, 20 years. You could buy them for a song on a graduate student's budget. You remember them? Yeah, the Gattinaras and the Gamays and the Cezanos and all that stuff that we eventually visited later on. Yeah, and so that sort of that gradual. You ask the question of like, is there any moment? Well, there isn't any really moment. It's just sort of like an evolution over time of us enjoying wine together. But we certainly had some moments that made kind of the jumps. I think 1984 was probably the year. We went to California together.
We toured California went through Napa and Sonoma and tasted wines there, of course.
We were crazy. We had tasting notes in the tasting room. We were writing about every wine.
Yeah.
Way back then.
And we were camping out.
It was kind of fun.
Yeah, heading down to San Diego and visit my family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that certainly was some big moments. And 84. Yeah, 84 was the first year that we started buying grapes, and we bought two grapes from two sources. One was from California, which was a group that grew out of Berkeley that had this great access. Back then, in the early days, I mean, people hardly knew anything about California wines. And they had access to some of the best vineyards, and so we were able to bring up grapes here.
They're called Wine and the People.
Wine and the People. and they really got a lot of kind of home winemakers going, because they just, and it gave you confidence because you had really, really good grapes. We had Cabernet, Merlot, Zin. Do we have any other varieties from California that year?
No, those were the three.
Yeah. And we recently had one of those 84 cabs that we made, and it was still tasting really good, like stunning. And then the other source of grapes that year, which is a complete opposite, which is really hilarious, was a guy named Chris Upchurch. Now, anybody who knows anything about Washington wines, he started DeLisle. And DeLisle is like a world-famous winery. But this is back before. He was in his home winemaking phase, too, and he was helping out a brew shop to bring in grapes from eastern Washington. And what makes 84 so interesting is that it was a fantastic year in California. And it is the most legendary year of being the worst vintage ever in Oregon. Anybody, any of the old timers who were around in that will go, oh my gosh, 84. And in fact, I recently saw Joel Myers, who was the vineyard manager for Irie back in that time period. And we were talking about climate. I saw him down at the McMinnville post office. And we kind of started talking about 84 because this year had this really weird spring. And he says, oh God, yeah. We gave up in early November and just brought the grapes in. Winter had started, and 18 bricks is about all we could get out of the grapes. It was an amazing year. Well, Eastern Washington had a slightly different problem. They got worried about frost. And so Upchurch brought all these grapes over before I thought a frost was going to really knock everything back. And these things were just
awful,
just the most acidic. you could put a hole in concrete with the acid that these things had. We ended up all throwing them all out.
And we didn't. We made wine.
Well, we made wine, but we eventually threw the wine
Riesling,
out.
Yeah. It was Riesling, and it was
Riesling. I think we had some Sauv Blanc and some Chardonnay.
Yeah, we tried it years later, thinking it would have mellowed.
Yeah, mellowed like a Chablis. No way. Oh, it was hilarious. You think we would have given up at that point? We went back to the well in 85 and bought some more grapes. But 85 was a big year, the year we decided to get married.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you had come down to Vancouver to be you kind of breaking the glass ceiling in the natural resource field for fish and wildlife agencies, and you were the regional wildlife biologist. Yeah,
In 85 we made the wine up in Bellingham.
Yeah.
At my dad's basement.
And 84 too.
I guess it was.
Both those years.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah, and they were very accommodating to let us use their nice cold basement in Bellingham to make wine.
But he likes to drink wine.
He likes to drink wine too, right? Yeah. Yeah, he made homebrew, so it was part of his concept of this is an acceptable behavior in our basement. And Yeah, so we never got any more Washington grapes after that. Although we were kind of curious about Washington as being a place to maybe even buy some land, but we never really pursued it too much.
No, we bought a quarter acre on a house.
Yeah, we bought
and planted grapes there, which allowed us to get a farm services loan to buy this land.
Yeah,
because we had grown grapes.
Yeah. Right.
A quarter acre. And they were about this high.
Yeah. So, yeah, in 85, we got married at Mount Rainier, and then up in the national park. And then but I think one of the really important kind of part of the story of kind of growing the passion for wine is that we have been enjoying Italian wines, especially the Piedmont and Rioja, the Tempranillos. And so we decided to go on our honeymoon to those two areas and bicycle for 3+ weeks. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a really important moment because it actually ended up influencing some decisions we made later on what varieties we actually planted here. And that passion for those wine regions has always continued. We really do like that, which just puts us kind of in a more kind of a diverse thought process compared to more of the Pinot Gris centric. We've always been interested in kind of a broader base of grape varieties. Mm-hmm. Anything you want to say about touring Italy?
We landed in Milan, and of course we were exhausted, but we put our bikes together. We had shipped our bikes over there, and they're the speed type bikes, touring bikes, and we were putting them together in the airport, and all these Italians were standing around, men, watching me put my bike together.
Yeah, they were just like fascinated, like a woman putting her bicycle together.
seemed to be kind of interesting to them, and then we went on this horrendous road to get to
Rona.
Yeah. The first Arona near the lakes and
Lake District,
and there was no room for bikes on that road, basically, and there was trucks going by, and so we were we had two different philosophies. Mark jumped off his bike every time a truck went by and went into the ditch, and I just hunkered down and sped on. And sometimes two trucks were passing, one going one way and one the other, and so I got to the end of the road, and there was a cafe or something with a parking lot, and I just waited and waited and waited. And I thought, oh, God, I'm already a widow. And slowly, then he comes, slowly pedaling down the road. And
I just couldn't take the traffic. It was just, it was too much.
He was
crazy Italian driver.
Me, probably.
Yeah, right. So that was a learning experience because that influenced how we went about bicycling for the rest of the trip. Because then we went to we got this map of the Piedmont, and it was a bicycle touring map, and it had color codes for the main highways, the secondary highways, and the less traveled highways. And what we noted was that all the valleys were the high traveled, and so it was up on the ridges, kind of following the ridges were the less traveled. And so we kind of then took the hard route and just kind of followed these mountainous trails all over the place, trying to get from point A to point B, but try to stay out of the valleys.
But you had to watch, you could hear the sports cars coming because they were going as fast as they could up those hills. But,
I think what we got out of that trip was just sort of kind of how wine was woven into the culture, and how it really was. It wasn't wine or food or anything like that. It wasn't separate. It was all kind of together, and people really would see wine as just sort of a beverage of life, and that has always stuck with us. Mm-hmm. It was one grape variety over there that was really important towards food and wine, which is a little bit more obscure of the Piedmontese grape varieties, is Dolcetto. all the press is about Nebbiolo, a little bit about Barbera. It's not much about Dolcetto. But if you go into there, you go into somebody's home or a trattoria, this is the wine of food. And that really impressed us, and we kind of put that into our kind of our brains, and it said, hey, if we ever get that vineyard, let's plant some Dolcetto. And sure enough, we didn't waste any time when we finally got the land. That was one of the first varieties we, but the interesting part was no nurseries. You couldn't go out and buy Dolcetto and plant it or get cuttings from it. We had to actually specifically get them out of the research block down at OSU and get about 15 or 20 cuttings and start a mother block and then plant it and plant it and plant it. But I'm getting ahead of the story here, aren't I? We're still back at 85.
Yeah.
Got back from the honeymoon and
I want to go further back than that because okay. I did a lot of things that you didn't do.
Yeah, you were in Italy. She was more of a world traveler than I was, so she brought a lot to the table. If you can talk about your things you did in Italy and maybe your adventures in Europe.
Before even that, we can back up even before you met. I'm curious about sort of how you each got to the University of Washington and pre-wine careers. So why don't you start there and take us up into that?
Yeah. Birds. Well, I was a grown-up in San Diego. I was there as things were developing. And so we used to, as kids, we'd play in all these vacant lots. And I rode horses that, you know, they were neighborhood horses, and we were about 7 miles from downtown. And by the time I was a teenager, I just wanted to get out of there. It had developed too much. It had smog now. It didn't. It used to get smog from L.A., but it had its own. So a friend of mine and I, we went to Cal State Hayward for 1 year. We didn't like the Bay Area, so then she looked up other schools, and we wound up in Bellingham. And I went there for a couple of years, and then I decided that I was tired of college. My degrees kept changing, and from archaeology at San Diego State to anthropology at Cal State Hayward to sociology, which I didn't like. And then I went into environmental studies up at Western, which was Huxley College at the time. And so I moved to Alaska and spent a year in Alaska working in a fish cannery and just enjoying myself, going winter camping and things like that. And then I came down and I lived in Idaho. My parents had some property and I built a little hut for myself. And then a friend of mine, my friend that I moved up to Bellingham with, said she was going to do a internship at College of the Atlantic in Bar Harbor, or Bahaba, as they pronounce it. and so I decided, well, yeah, I'd like to see Maine. So I went with her to Maine and a couple other friends and lived there for a few months. And then we toured back across the country, went to Mexico, where half her family was, and then came back and came back to Bellingham and then spent a year getting my degree in environmental studies. And at that point, I wanted to work on a study of wolves in Europe. And so I decided that's probably going to be Sweden or Norway, which sounded like a lot of fun. And turned out it was Italy. That was the only study of wolves in Europe. And so I wrote to them and got they said, yeah, sure, come. And so I worked on their wolf study for about 4 months, driving around the hills in the Apennines, where there was 100 wolves that they had radio collared. And
the Abruzzi.
Trying to, yeah, in the Abruzzi area. Mm-hmm. And that's where I got really introduced to the Italian wine culture, because we would go. There was the Italian researcher there. Of course, luckily they all spoke English, but I did learn Italian. I was just getting good at it when I left. But there was a researcher there. His family lived nearby, and so he, you know, in the mornings we'd go out and, you know, have a just a focaccia for breakfast. Then in the afternoons we'd go to some cafe and, you know, get our carafe of wine. And then we'd go get a carafe of wine and bring it back to the house where we were staying. And so it was just, it was really fun. And doing, you know, like the polenta feasts that they had, where they spread this polenta on these huge tables and everybody has to eat to the middle to get the sausages and stuff that are in the middle. And so just getting introduced to that culture. Eventually my friend and I, she had gone to Scotland and we traveled Europe. And then I came back and I worked, got a summer fall job of working, studying spotted owls and cavity nesting birds, like woodpeckers and those type of birds. And at the Darrington District up in Bellingham, or Washington. And from that, I decided to get a master's at University of Washington in wildlife science. And so I went there and went for a couple years, met Mark there, but he was not available, and I wasn't available. And then I went to Costa Rica with the boyfriend I was with at the time, and he was studying bats, fruit-eating bats, and going to study that for his PhD. And so I helped him on his study, and then I did some small bat studies on making, I built a cage, a big cage, and then we'd capture these bats in mist nets, and then I'd put them in the cage, and they would, I'd hang these fruit from the top of the cage and see which ones they ate. And most of them didn't like living in the cage at all, so we'd let them go pretty quick. But, and then I came back, and my boyfriend and I broke up, and Mark was available, and we met on a bus in Seattle. Yeah, I had to finish my master's thesis. I couldn't do that.
We were both working on birds at the time.
Yeah. Well, I had worked. Yeah, you helped me. Yeah. He helped me do some of his study plots, and I helped him.
Yeah. We were both on the Olympic Peninsula.
Yeah.
She was in the National Forest, and I was in the National Park. And these, you know, kind of, you know, that just, that's kind of sort of the simple part of it. But really, these are brutally difficult landscapes to work in. And it's raining all the time. Steep slopes, and we're, so it's kind of a shared experience.
Stepping on yellow jackets.
Yeah, just, you know, your shins are just always have bruises all over from hitting logs, and then, you know, each of us had, some of us, each, we both had plots in old growth forests, which were just these sort of charming, beautiful places that
you could walk through.
You could walk through until you hit it, you saw a gigantic log that you had to crawl over.
Right.
Right, yes. So yeah, it's kind of that shared experience, which then led to shared experience in wine and all that stuff. But, so how about if I get us to the
sure.
point where we shared experience on birds. I by the time I had finished either freshman in high school, or I mean freshman in college, I had a lot of several, a lot of travel experience in the U.S., whereas Jill was a little bit more international. And I think I had been to just about every state at that point, except for Hawaii and Alaska, which you couldn't drive to easily. I kind of a national park junkie, and I had a bunch of friends that we would go to all these national parks in the summertime, and visiting Yellowstone and Grand Canyon and Teton and a bunch of the obscure ones all the way up to Banff in Canada, and it was a great time, and it actually, that was a very important thing, because I ended up working for the National Park Service later in my career. And but during that kind of that exploratory stage is sort of just more and more getting enthused about nature, which is what you were also enthused about. So that kind of the crossroad there.
And my parents, it was really funny. They had more of a tradition. My dad was a businessman. You know, they thought this whole thing about interest in nature and birds was just sort of something in passing. You know, the kid will get through this again. but it wasn't, because when I was an undergraduate, I had two other colleagues who ended up both in careers in nature, studying birds or marine mammals or raptors, and we spent every possible available time at our undergraduate just going out and going bird watching or just spending time in nature on the Appalachian Trail, and that sort of made me shift my career from business, which I started in, to biology, to forestry environmental studies, to ecology, which I had finished up studies at Duke, and then was in charge of a forest protection program for the state of Maryland in charge of all their insect and disease forest situation. I said, nah, I don't want to stay here for the rest of my life. I'd already gotten the bug about coming out west, and I thought, well, I need to get out there, and the only way I could do is come back to graduate school. It was kind of a stupid reason to go back to graduate school, but that's what I did.
And
perpetual student was kind of inviting, especially in that era in the 70s. You know, everybody spent a lot of time. You could live on a lot less then. You know,
yeah.
it was easier. You don't really get into a lot of debt back then. And so that's what led me to the University of Washington. I came out, hooked up with a guy who was working for the National Park Service and studying birds. I was studying birds relative to fires. And Jill was studying birds relative to cavity nesting birds relative to kind of forest succession.
Yeah.
Some of them cut areas, some of them not cut areas, and so that kind of led us to, you know, just have these mutual interests that we just sort of shared and mm-hmm. kind of grew from there mm-hmm. into wine, into and other things, and eventually getting married. And yeah, that brings it back to 1985, doesn't it? Anything you want to share? Because 85, actually, I had a thought here that 85 was pretty important because it kind of begins to fold in the walls.
Yeah.
So 85. We were living in Clark County, just north of Portland there, and we joined this fledgling new group that was forming, a wine tasting group. I mean, that's pretty unusual for the mid 80s.
In Vancouver,
yeah. They were based. They're called the Columbia Willamette. And Jill, being the kind of person who likes to really take charge, she became president of it. And I was just really excited about the tasting. So actually, I took charge for almost 10 years of organizing their tastings, and those were a real educational moment mm-hmm. for us. So there's kind of another kind of bonding, but learning along the way, is we would have these tastings, like we would pick a village like Pommard in back when you could afford Burgundies, and we would do 8 to 10 Pommards in the evening, and then we'd move to the next village, I mean, we need to kind of intensively look at that and try to understand it, and we do them a couple times a month. It was a blast, and mm-hmm. it really honed us in on the flavors of the world. And we weren't just doing Pinot Noir, we were doing Italy, we were doing Bordeaux, and the list goes on and on, and it was just a lot of fun. And through that club, so the kind of more important part was through that club, we met Roy and Betty Wall, who lived out here, yeah. or just up the road, and they would go all the way to Vancouver to come to these tastings. Just to show you how rare it is to have that kind of opportunity to really taste some good wine and enjoy it with other people. And then we got hooked up into Roy and Betty through the fact that they said, oh yeah, we sell grapes to home winemakers. Now at that point we had been just buying the California and walked away from Washington. And we never looked back after that. We just said, well, this sounds really interesting. Being able to actually go out in the vineyard, be pick the grapes, and be involved. And then there was a whole then we discovered there's a whole cadre of home winemakers that were involved with the walls. They sold, there were a lot of people in the West Side Wine Club out of Beaverton, who I think Erath and Ponzi got started that group, and then it had evolved over time. But I know Scott Scholl came out here from Raptor Ridge. There's a long list of folks that kind of were just in this little neighborhood here. It was a lot of fun. And we would come out and do the netting parties. Back then, you know,
they got free labor.
Yeah, free labor. Before Climate Way, they had wine and food. That was
fun.
Yeah,
they definitely had great food.
Yeah, but this is back before climate change really took hold. I mean, all the harvests back then were in October. And the birds would have arrived by then, and it was a big battle. And they put up netting every year. And so we would help them with that. And then we'd get the grapes, and we started making wine. And we made wine from their vineyard up until ours went commercial, right up until 1993. So there was a real learning mm-hmm. process. Oh, one of the more important parts of that was the experimental block. OSU had planted one of the first experimental clonal trial blocks in the Wall Vineyard, because they're one of the earlier vineyards. And Roy and Betty said, you know, that block's a pain in the neck to us, because all different clones ripen at different times, and it's hard to kind of sell it to a winemaker. So they let us loose in that clonal block. And that was a huge learning curve, because we made individual lots from each one of those clones. And this was all the early stuff. All the California, this is before Dijon clones. This is the California clones, and some really interesting oddball clones that we eventually planted some mm-hmm. here. But the one that was significantly we planted the most that we really, really like was an Alsatian clone called Colmar 538. And we still have about 300 vines out there. Some of the older ones we planted in 1990 are, you know, they've gone by the wayside, self-rooted. Yeah, and some Spanish clones, the Bebe clone. Mm-hmm. We had that out there. There was just a whole bunch. I can't remember. But anyway, we had all the individual blocks, batches, and we could then see from those batches what are the attributes of these different clones in small lots, how they might be blended together. So, like, Pommard was the big thing, Pommard and Badensville, but mostly Pommard, and Roy Betty Will had a lot of Pommard, and so we would kind of use the Pommard as the base and then play with all the other clones and mix blending it with Pommard. We did mm-hmm. that for a long time, and that was really an interesting learning curve for us. I don't think there's anything else about 85 but
well, they told us that this property was for sale.
Well, that's 80.
Not 85.
That was 80.
That was 88.
88, 89.
Yeah.
But actually, yeah, they told 89. Us this property was for sale, and also something else happened right at that time period that was just like really
big change.
Yeah, that just pushed us in the side and said, you've got to do this. Mm-hmm. You've got to go buy the land. No matter, even if you're in your 30s, you've got to go buy the land. And that was, The Oregon wine industry at that time had been working very hard to up their profile worldwide, especially at least in the U.S., and trying to get a French winemaker to come here. And they've been really trying hard. And they finally got Domaine Drawn to come in. And I think they bought the property in 88 and started building the winery in 89. And we just looked at each other and went, this industry is about to change. Huge. It's not going to be the same. And we said, well, no matter what, let's go get the land now. And you know, the concept of land, it was really important. The land is actually as important, and probably more important than the wine. Mm-hmm. You can see here we have this beautiful 10-acre woodland behind us. When we heard this property came available, it wasn't just a place where you can grow fantastic grapes for wine, but it had this wildlife component that really appealed to us, because mm-hmm. we have this biologist wildlife background. And it really has proven to be kind of our hidden treasure. I mean, we've had bobcats in here, we've had foxes nesting and denning, and we've had over 115 species of birds that we've identified, and it's just been a lot of fun mm-hmm. having that treasure as it juxtapositioned sort of from a biodiversity perspective right next to the vineyard. And I'm talking way too much, so I'm going to let Jill talk about maybe the first years when we were kind of planting and your folks were helping us and we had no road and all that kind of, it was quite a struggle.
Yeah, we bought it in 89, and there was a small, there was a well already on the property. Somebody had drilled the well, the well who was looking to buy it, and it didn't produce enough water, so they backed out. And it was for sale by owner, so we got it at a great price. And bought it in 80, like the winter of, or the December, November of 89, and then we started planting. We got cuttings from the walls and
and ivy
at the same time. Yeah, from muscat.
And Pinot. Yeah.
We knew David Glett, and then we liked muscat wines, and he loved muscat wines. So we got our first muscat Otonelle from him.
And plus, we went to Canelli when we went to Italy, too, which that's a whole other story.
Yes.
Canelli is the, Muscat Canelli is the town of Canelli.
Yeah,
is,
but you were sick then.
No,
you
I was sick. I had food poisoning.
Yeah. Anyway, so we had these cuttings, and we, well, what we first started doing is we had to root them. So we had brought in some sawdust, but there was just a kind of a track there, and it was really muddy, and we had to start from the county road, Blackburn Road, and come this way. So we had one of these big wooden carts that you pull. We didn't have a tractor or ATV or anything, and we I have this picture of my Mark and my father kind of leaning over this thing that they've been trying to pull through the mud full of sawdust and cuttings, and we eventually got it to a place where we could start the cuttings, and we didn't plant that year, obviously. The next year we planted when they were rooted, and we had some friends come out and help, and we had to run a generator for the water, because we had no electricity here.
It was pretty primitive.
Yeah, it was very primitive.
But we were dedicated, and on the top of it all, were we still in Vancouver at that point?
We had, I think we might have been. We moved to Lafayette.
Commuting.
Yeah, we rented a house in Lafayette for
1990.
And we had some homemade wine up in our house in Vancouver, it was Battleground, and so we transported this stuff in barrels, small barrels, down to this little 900 square foot house.
And we had to buy air conditioning for the room.
Put it in one of the tiny little bedrooms, and put an air conditioner in there. And anyway, but then we started coming here. We were able to come here more often and manage the grapes.
And the building of the house too.
And then we got a contractor to build the house, and so we got the road built here, we got electricity in, we got, you know, the septic and built, dug a well up there. So, you know, it had been a sheep farm before us. Before that, it had been a cherry farm. Before that, it had been a prune farm. Before that, it was walnut, and there's still wild cherries out here, feral cherries. And
plums.
And, there's feral prunes, and there's feral apples, and there's walnut trees popping up all the time. Mm-hmm. But, so it had the history, basically, of Yamhill, of the type of agriculture that kind of swept through the different eras in this property.
Yeah, that's probably a little bit of a historical property in the sense that, you know, the house out by the row is probably, people told us it was dated maybe to the 1920s, but we found another homestead on one of the flats down there in the vineyard that we found, you know, pieces of potbelly stove and stuff like that. So it probably dated way before that other house that was built in, yeah, the 1920s.
And how we found the potbelly stove is we were drilling a hole for the grapes or the fence, I guess, and it didn't go anywhere. And so we're like, what is going on here? So we pull out the drill and then we dug and, you know, had to dig for this front of a pot-bellied stove. And there was, yeah, it was right down on the flat there where we now have Tempranillo. Yeah. And there's pottery. They obviously had put a pipe into where the pond is down there, where it was probably a spring, and eventually probably had electricity. There was some evidence of that. And it looked like it had all burned down. We found some other, lots of square nails and big horseshoe and, you know, all sorts of things that were historical. That was, and there's no evidence in the record of that being, that might have been somebody's homestead back in the 1800s or early 1900s. But yeah, but the what is, we call a shed, but at the very start of our driveway, that's actually an old house that when we moved here, there's a brick house at the start of the road, and there was a elderly woman living in it, and she had lived in that house that's at the front of our road. And so there was history here. She's long gone now, but yeah, so we just kind of slowly planted the vineyard, acre at a time.
The craziness of the high-density vineyard.
I was going to ask about that.
Yeah.
Tell me about
that. That was pretty nutty.
That's your deal.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, you know, in the travels to Europe, it was evident that they planted things a little differently than what we had seen in California. Where these just gigantic wide open rows that you could get a big John Deere down. There was, everything was narrow. The spacings were really narrow, and we just, we had known that Burgundy was like even narrower. They grew it like hedges, and you know, we'd seen lots of pictures of that, and we thought, well, you know, these people have been doing this for like centuries. There must be something to this, and what we had heard from growers that, a little competition between the vines is good for enhancing flavor development, the depth of the wines. And so we didn't waste any time. We were one of the first in Oregon, well, actually, about the same time that we had the idea, we also had heard rumor that Domaine Drong came in and they did the same thing. They planted high density. I don't know whether they still do it anymore, but and that we knew that would probably take us on a journey that we wouldn't have a lot of colleagues to interact with. What kind of wines would it make? What are the challenges in the vineyard? We knew that it would be challenging from a managing things like mildew because the plants are really close together. It'd be a lot of hand labor, it'd be more expensive. From a business plan perspective, it wasn't very smart, was it? But it made some great wines, but that's another story.
3,000 vines per acre,
3,000
approximately.
Vines per acre, which was, our neighbor across the street, I think, was probably 500 or 800 vines per acre. And so we were multiplying that by many fold. It looked pretty crazy at the time. I think it was the thing that was even crazier is that we did this and we knew they did not have the same farm equipment as they had in Europe. They had not brought the narrow tractors in yet. We were just kind of hoping when they would show up. So the only thing that we could do at that time was there was a lot of it was managed that Yamaha, bless their hearts, for just a couple years had a PTO-driven ATV, and we could run all this equipment off of that. And You know, it was kind of survival mode, and then till the tractor caught up, and I guess it was probably about 5 or 6 more years when they started bringing in
the Kubotas,
Kubotas and the Carraros. And some of the big names started looking at narrow tractors from Europe, but we ended up buying an Italian tractor because that was one of the first ones that came in, is the Carraros, and it's just really, you know, it really says Europe when you look at it. It's just really narrow and small. And that was our saving grace. I don't know if we've been able to expand much further what we were doing with the ATV at that point. It was pretty crazy to be committed to narrow spacing without the tractor, but we had hoped that it would catch up, and it did, fortunately. And it really presented its own sets of challenges over time for kind of managing the grapes, very labor intensive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, tell me about the experience of once you started to install the vineyard. What were the challenges that were specific to you, especially as you mentioned, not having necessarily people you could bounce ideas off of or ask for help?
Well, the first big challenge was that we are not as short as the French, so to speak, and they grow their hedge, but the fruiting wire's down here, and I had. There's no way I am going to bend over that much to harvest grapes. So actually invented our own trellis design, where the fruiting wire is up around belly height. The renewal cane is above the canopy, one or two are above the canopy, and then the rest of the grapes are, or the shoots are grown down. Or at least there are wires available to it. In some cases, they kind of just run wild if we don't get around to it. But it allowed us a very important back saving, and we could actually have people that would be willing to harvest the grapes. I don't know how they do it in Italy. I guess they are in France. A lot of it is mechanically harvested. No, they still do a lot of hand labor over there, but it is kind of nutty how low it is to the ground. So that was one way that we kind of got to the challenge. The other thing we were very worried about was the vigor. Back then, there was a lot more rainfall, very cool springs. You have these cool springs, so just things are growing out of control. So we wanted to make sure that the vigor was controlled through not only tight spacing, but we kept, we did no tilling, so we had a cover crop, a year-round cover crop. And which we're really committed to today. This industry standard is you leave one row with a cover crop, and the other row you till, and we're much more into the no-till. This is dry land farming, unlike a lot of the new developments happening now. That was a big experiment to see how the plants responded to some of the pressure points that we would provide to control the vigor, and it worked really well. I would say, when climate change started to really roll in about 2014 and beyond, it was kind of a lot harder on the plants, and I wouldn't recommend now that high a density. For the record, because of climate change, it worked well with the climate of the 80s and 90s, but now it's too dense. And any new plantings that we've done, we've pulled back to about 2,400 per acre. And we go with two canes rather than one cane at the high density. So it's,
Our goal was to have to intensify the flavors by stressing the vines, and because at that time we believed Oregon was wet. So you stress the vines, you have them all, a meter apart, and then 1.6 meter rows, but every other row is a meter. So we have two rows here, meter apart, and then the next row, couple rows over, are 1.6 meter, and then you got another meter, and then so it's a alternating.
And I can only take equipment
down the wider
the 1.6 meter row, which is about 5 feet,
right?
And the other one, It's a hand management to keep things from getting too entangled.
Yeah, we had an exceptional mower that could we fit down that 1 meter row, and just it was a hand mower though, so it was a big pain in the
power
mower. Yeah. It finally wore out. But.
Yeah. So it is very challenging. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but the attention was we liked full flavored Pinot Noirs. You know, we're fine with lighter styles. I thought David Lett got very light wine that had a lot of complexity. Mm-hmm. And that's
he knew the art of that.
Yeah, he knew the art of that. Uh-huh. And but we tend to make the bigger style Pinot Noirs, although depending on the vintage, sometimes
A lot of structure.
Structure.
Yeah, not like a California big. It's just kind of has a lot of depth, and we're looking for those long finishes.
Yeah, we're not looking for big, huge fruit. We want that depth and that complexity that Oregon wines have that go on and on and on, and you remember them.
Yeah. Kevin Chambers asked me once, why are you doing this high density stuff? And it's just very expensive. He couldn't understand it, and rightfully so. We said, well, we're creating our own sort of flavor profile niche in the marketplace, and to be different. And that's what we've done. And we have a real good base of customers who appreciate. Aging wines. I mean, that's really what we're chasing. We're chasing the being able to have enough structural component coming from the vineyard, coming from the grapes, that allows a wine to develop that over time and then holds. And all of our wines really have held well for 20 years or more. And so. And we have customers who are willing to age. Now, we realize society's changed now, and everybody kind of wants to do anything right away, and nobody has a cellar, but there's still people out there that can appreciate your... And so we've kind of shifted a little bit, and you know, we age our wines for them. We will sell them on futures so they can access them if they want to put them in their basement, get them at a good price. But mainly, we actually bring out the wines after 4, 5, 6 years, which is really unusual for Oregon. And then that's when they're beginning to really taste. They've sort of that structure now is integrated. It's much more approachable in its flavors. That's not, you can't walk into too many tasting rooms and say, well, look at all these older wines that you can actually purchase. We have a long list of older wines.
Our first vintage was 1994, and we got 72 cases out of those young vines. It was, maybe 2 acres of Pommarden Colmar 538, and they were that was a very dry year,
and
the berries were about the size of a little bit bigger than a pea.
A little extracted on
not
that
a
vintage.
Young pea, an older pea, but still, so it was very extracted. But we haven't tasted one for a while. But the last time we tasted it, it's still holding up.
Yeah, holding up great.
So
it took a while to come around.
Yeah, it took a while to come around.
So we realized that patience was very important. But I think. One important thing that we haven't mentioned yet is that we kept our day jobs probably for a couple different reasons. One is we really enjoy what our careers we were trained in. Jill's very passionate about conservation, and is even though she's retired, she's still active. The governor appointed her to be on the Fish and Wildlife Commission. She's now serving on that.
No, the Senate appointed me.
Oh, the
governor nominated me.
Nominated, okay, all right. Get that government stuff.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, and even though I recently retired from the National Park Service, I'm still doing work for them, and I'm on a county task advisory force to help them with vegetation roadside management. So just kind of giving back to the community and kind of do these things. And Jill's president of the AVA. So So the kind of the
yeah, Mel Carlton.
Yeah, I'm Carlton. So what that kind of did is that we really did not want to walk away and go full force into the wines. We reached somewhere in that 2,000 case and last felt that we could. We could handle it. Mm-hmm. We've pulled back because of distribution a little bit since then because of all those woes. But whatever we could handle and still keep the full-time job. But what's important about that is that kind of reduce stress in our lives because we still had the financial resources. But we were going to need to do that because we were making these wines that we had to sit on for many years before we could actually sell them. So it was almost by default that we really needed to kind of retain that extra income. But it wasn't really all about extra income. It was about that we were very passionate about the things we were doing, especially in conservation and. Mm-hmm. And I was more into the science end of conservation. Jill was more into sort of the policy management end, and we have kind of great overlap with those two topics. We have a lot in common, mm-hmm. and then the sort of the patience game it was really important.
But this labor market has affected everybody. I mean, including us. We lost our two part-time workers, field workers.
The family had been with us for 28 years.
Yeah, this year when they went to a bigger winery, which I don't blame them because we couldn't provide them with the year-round living that they needed. And we shared them with the Yamhill vineyards across the way there. And, there would be months they wouldn't be working. And they have kids. So, we understand why they left, but that's another reason why our vineyard's kind of crawling all over the place, because it's just Mark and
a couple of
friends helping out.
It's been a great experiment. I really actually have liked how the vines have responded. They actually are looking good. They just need a little.
They grab him in the vineyard.
a little TLC. This vintage is not exactly one where you. It's a head scratcher of vintage, but we don't need to go in there because of the kind of the freeze that hit all of Oregon.
And we're also selling wine in Washington. Purple Cafe has been using us for a few years now, 4 or 5 years, their
four vintages, something like that.
Yeah,
three vintages,
as their house wine, and we can distribute to a few states. We have California customers, or a lot of Oregon customers, some Washington customers. And a few across the country. Seem to have a few in Florida, which is a real pain to ship to because you could only ship like 2 months of the year.
The southern tier is really difficult to work with if you want to make sure that the wines are taken care of. There's hardly any time you can really actually ship to them.
But there's kind of a continuing story of getting a distributor and then they either get sold or to a bigger distributor. We were distributed in Arizona for a while, and then they sold to another one. We were distributed in Washington for a while. They got, bigger and bought, and also there was a recession, and, so it was all these.
Yeah, it happened every state.
Yeah, every state we've gone to, something like that's happened.
It's exhausting. So. It really is exhausting to kind of. You start up these relationships, and then all of a sudden, it just kind of takes a right turn. Mm-hmm. And so we've actually pulled back on we're trying to now just mostly direct sales to customers, mm-hmm. private labels. We have a number of restaurants, and like Jill mentioned, the Purple Cafe, and we have some locally here that we make their wines, mm-hmm. And that's kind of that's a little bit more of a. In a way, it's kind of fun because you develop a different kind of relationship with kind of a single customer. And, they get good value on what you're providing to them because they're not getting it through the three-tier system. But so we've been kind of, shifting and adapting over time. And we've gotten a lot smaller. We used to be, we bought grapes from a couple of our neighbors, and we've pulled back on that. Mainly as kind of time went on after the 2008 recession, which things got a little, there's just a whole consolidation in the wine industry, harder to sell wine, mm-hmm. and a lot happened after that. And so we these are our good friends, and it was very hard to not buy wines, buy their grapes anymore, because they've been our neighbors for 15, 20, 30 years. And now we just do estate, and even there we're just kind of focused on the estate, which pretty much puts us at about 1,000 cases a year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 1,000, 1,200.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So in the journey from planting and first bottling wine to now, tell me about the process of learning viticulture and learning winemaking for yourselves. You mentioned the kinds of wines you wanted to make, the niche in the market, the kind of the interesting planting design. What were the biggest steps for you in terms of feeling like you had viticulture, kind of you understood viticulture, understood winemaking, understood how to do what you wanted to do to produce the product you wanted to make?
Well, on the viticulture end, I think we've probably covered pretty good and talked about what we've done in the vineyard.
There was this book that the wine industry with OSU put out back in the 80s.
Yeah, there was the Oregon Grape Growers Guide. That was a very good resource.
Yeah.
And plus, we had neighbors to kind of talk about, right. And sharing crews.
And there was the Hort Society.
Hort Society meeting. We went to a lot of scientific meetings together.
Yeah, one thing I want to bring up also is that when we started, there was maybe 50 wineries in the whole state. And we would have these, we were members of the Yamhill County Wine Growers Association, and they would have... We'd have picnics at Rex Hill or someplace else, and everybody knew each other. And
yeah, it was great.
Yeah, just their kids were there, you know, and it was all kind
oriented.
Of a family affair. Yeah, yeah. And of course, the wine industry now is, you know, we're getting more corporations coming in, but most of them, I'd say, have been trying to fit into this Oregon cooperative, you know, effort.
Mm-hmm.
And even the, you know, existing wineries who have been here for a long time, who've, you know, gotten bigger, they're still into that cooperative mode. So it's changed from, 900 wineries now, from 50 when we started. And it, you know, when we started, and a lot of the other people that you've been interviewing who've been around for, you know, 20, 30 years, it was real easy for families, for just a couple people, you know, one maybe had a job or they both had jobs, just to start out in this business out of passion. And I'd say that there's still people doing that.
It's harder.
A lot of young people, yeah.
Especially for the land perspective.
Yeah, for the land is so expensive now. But if they can buy grapes and they can set up at another winery, you know, that's what... Where we're making our wine is we're a winery within a winery.
Mm-hmm.
And we started out as grower sales privilege license, but now for a number of years, since 07, I think, mm-hmm. we've been a winery within a winery. Mm-hmm. So that's an option for people. And so a lot of people can start out in the business, but they wouldn't have land for quite a while, probably.
Yeah, and if you really want to control sort of the quality of the grape production end of it, which is what we really wanted to do,
mm-hmm.
That becomes a little bit more challenging for the new people getting started, and they're pretty much at the mercy of what the grower is willing to negotiate with you about, and what kind of things you can tweak in their vineyard in terms of either. You know, crop loading or going organic or who knows what. It's a whole long list. And Well, I think I'll try to answer a little bit more of the some additional
sure.
things on the question. So we grow four varieties. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We grow Muscat, Pinot Noir, about 10 different clones, and Dolcetto. And then the latecomer in that is Tempranillo.
Mm-hmm.
They each have their own kind of journey with how we, approached the production end of it. Certainly the most challenging is Pinot Noir. I mean, we were just having a a barrel tasting last night, and we barely agreed on anything. it was remarkable, and it was just the same story year in and year out. To try
his,
to find
his number ones or best was my number two and a plus or something.
the whole concept of and then you know the other varieties. There's just no disagreement. In fact, there's very once you taste them a couple times in the barrel, there's really not a lot of reason to try them much again until you get near bottling, because they kind of have this, and they go right like this, and you pretty much know where they're going. You've already kind of figured out which ones are going in. Either if you have a two-tier of wine, you can, we have a superiority for our Dolcetto. We can already figure out where they're going. But with Pinot, it's just like up and down, up and down. And sometimes we do these tastings back-to-back, day one, day two, taking samples out. And, of course, they're changing between days. All the things we liked the first day, they're now down in kind of the lower tier of the second day. And so you have, this accumulated data. These are blind tastings that we're collecting from, for 3 months or 4 months. And you just look at it at the end and go, like, what to do? Well, usually what we do is put more emphasis on the more the later stuff and try to find some kind of commonality or agreement on our palates. We do have different palates. I tend I think I like a little more fullness on the wine. I think you like a little bit brighter fruit, and so the blending of our palates is really I think makes a better wine than one individual alone. But yes, so the Pinot is challenging. We make an older block, our first planting. It's called Vendange Selections Pinot Noir. It used to have a little bit of Colmar 538 in it, but it doesn't anymore because the Colmar 538 has since passed on. And that's our only single clone or single site. A block among the wines that we make for Pinot, and then we make a reserve, which is always a big blend, no dominant particular clone. It's usually about 8 clones or more, whatever clones are showing the best for that particular vintage, and then we occasionally make one called Reserve 777114, when those two clones will show themselves unique enough to bottle them separately from the rest of it. We don't have customers saying, well, it's a lot like that wine. You don't really want to do that. And what we found is sort of in the warmer vintages, we may not make those clones because they don't really express themselves as uniquely as they do in the more, I won't call them cooler years, but just in the years where it isn't super hot, like a 2015. And then we have a kind of an entry level, which is also a big blend of a lot of clones, our Yamhill Carlton. And so that's kind of what we do with Pinot. But Dolcetto was another journey. That was a really interesting variety, very difficult to harness in the vineyard, to figure out how to crop load it. I mean, it has these gigantic clusters. They're like, could be a pound each. And you could fit 5 Pinot clusters into a Dolcetto cluster, and so balanced pruning and balanced management in the vineyard was it took a number of years to figure that out, and then we did a lot of the propagation ourselves early on, and got it up to about 1,000 vines or more, and made a couple barrels, and this was 98, 99, and 2000 is when we really seriously looked at it commercially. We had some experimental wines before that, and everybody liked it. It was like, wow, this is like another great component that Ori could really do. It never has actually taken off, it's been a solid seller for us for 20 plus years, and it's a hand sell. People come to the tasting room and say, this is like, wow, this is terrific, and we price it just like they do in Italy. It's meant to be an everyday wine. You'd have it with your weekday pasta, but it took a long time to figure out in the winery. The earlier batches were a little too rustic. Natural yeast didn't work all that well. the using some of the Pinot Noir yeast didn't work that well, and then so we finally was playing around with some yeast, and this one, oh boy, this one really, it was meant to bring out a lot more kind of fruit character, and it has just been made solid dolcettos ever since that. It's been smooth sailing, just made really, really beautiful, beautiful wines. Mm-hmm. Muscat has been an interesting journey. We've made ice wines from it. We've made white ports, which distributors wouldn't carry, so we had to, and we found out the hard way. It took years to sell out of the tasting room. We just pulled one out the other day. It's still tasting great from the 98-99 vintage. We, for some reason or other, blended it with a little bit of Chardonnay a few years, and that was kind of an interesting wine, a little bit on the sweet side. We said, well, why are we doing this? I mean, we could sell it. A lot of people liked it, but we wouldn't drink it because we don't like sweet wines. And the ports were dryish, you know, just a hint of sugar. They're more like a sherry type, dry sherry. I finally said to Jill, you know, I don't really have patience for white wine. I'm really a red wine maker.
Can I tell what happened to you?
No.
You're sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
Okay.
We would have to edit that out.
Okay. That'll be off record.
Yeah. Let's just say I blew up a bladder on a press, and I couldn't hear for a couple of days, a small press, and
It did other things.
Scattered seeds everywhere all over my body. I think I just had enough of white wine at that point, and I said I know a guy who I really admire what he does with white wines. Excuse me.
Control yourself.
Brian O'Donnell down at Belpont. He really is passionate about white wines. He does a great job with them. And so we developed a partnership for the Muscat. And what we did is that we would make these outstandingly good Muscats in the Vineyard, blend of Muscat, Otonelle, and early Muscat, about 30-60. And we'd bring them down to Brian, and then he would work his kind of shepherding and magic in the vineyard, and then we would divide up the proceeds in terms of the wines in the bottle, and we would each sell the Muscat. And that's been a 16-year partnership, we get together every few years and taste old Muscats, and it's amazing how some of them have been lasting a decade or more.
Yeah.
And a lot of that, I think, you know, the crazy thing is we planted the Muscat at high density. It's over 2,000 an acre. And Joel Myers looked at us when he brought the cuttings over. He said, "You're going to plant these at high density? Why are you doing that?" Well, you know, that in Italy, they plant them at a high density, and I think you might get a little more structure, flavor out of it. And they're really good. God, they're great eating grapes, too. Yeah.
Especially the early Muscat.
Yeah, especially the early Muscat. But we never made really a true dessert wine out of it or anything like that. We are passionate about a dry Muscat, like to have an Alsace, where you'd walk into a restaurant and you'd order a trout dinner or some kind of something that would go well with a white wine. That's one of their five really important white grapes in Alsace. And so we've kind of worked towards in that direction. And of course, Brian is very passionate about the Alsatian grapes as well. Just a terrific partnership, and really enjoyed working with Brian and Jill. And then the last grape variety is Tempranillo, which that was our global climate change variety, although you could claim that Dolcetto is too, because it actually comes in even later than Tempranillo. But that has a really interesting story. Nobody in the Willamette, I mean, you had Abicella come in, and they put Tempranillo on the map in Oregon. Great wines from the Roseburg area, Umpqua Valley, and he then helped popularize that as sort of a signature Southern Oregon variety. Well, we kind of looked at that and went, you know, we went to Rioja, we love Tempranillo, we could plant it someday, but maybe the time isn't right. But there was this thing that happened with the researchers down at the Medford station, a guy named Porter Lombard. He used to follow phenology of grapes, and he had planted Pinot and Tempranillo side by side down there. And for years and years and years, Pinot and Tempranillo would ripen at the same time. And I heard that, he had tell us that in the 80s, and I went, that's kind of interesting. And so fast forward to about 2005, we planted a little experimental block of a couple rows of Tempranillo, and it looked like it was doing pretty good, but we never got to the point of actually making any experimental wine out of it, because we got to 2008, and we, being in the natural resource field, we're very sensitive to sort of climate change. It's in front of us all the time in terms of conservation of species and habitats. And it was very clear to us that we had arrived at a moment when climate change was just beginning to really take off. And we just kind of looked at each other and said, yeah, why not? Why don't we try Tempranillo? And we are now on 14 was our first harvest. We had some hits and misses. Or 12, we didn't quite have enough in production from 2008 planting to make a separate bottling out of it. 13, it was a tough vintage with a lot of rain, and then the birds got it all, every drop of it.
They love
Tempranillo. So 14 was the first vintage. But the end of the story is every vintage we've been able to ripen Tempranillo really well. It makes a very compelling wine here in the Northern Willamette Valley. I just really think it has a great future. And the funniest part of the end of the story is that it ripens. If you have the right clones, it ripens at the same time as Pinot Noir. And in fact, it interrupts Pinot Noir harvest because we have to go over here and harvest the Tempranillo or it's not going to be able to, it will be too
sweet. The birds will get it.
The birds will get it, right, yeah. It kind of fits in with sort of the experimental end of, we've always, research and development kind of thought process. We've always had kind of unusual grape varieties. Who in the world would think of planting Dolcetto back in the early 90s? I think Ponzi maybe had a little bit at that time, but nobody was planting Dolcetto at that time. And so that's been a long journey and an interesting one. I think I better stop talking.
Well, I don't have any. He's the vineyard manager and the winemaker, so that's true.
Yeah. Did that answer your question?
Absolutely, it did. Since you both kept your careers until fairly recently, I'd like to ask sort of about your kind of parallel career in the natural sciences. Joe, let's start with you. Tell me a little bit about the career path you took outside of wine, and maybe some career highlights.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I after working on spotted owls and the wolf study, I did a little bit more work for Seattle City Light on just finding spotted owls in some area that they were maybe looking at putting a reservoir in, but they never did. And I got my master's, and then I went to work for Washington Department of Wildlife at the time. Now it's Fish and Wildlife, but back then it was just wildlife. And I was worked on habitat issues. There was a lot of incentives to put in hydro, and there was people running around, kind of like now with the solar. They were running around wanting to put hydro everywhere, and so there would be a stream running flat, and they were going, they're going to put hydro there, and we're like, no, you're not, you know, full of salmon, steelhead. And I think one of the highlights was that there was a one of these hydro developers wanted to put a hydro in on the Dosey Wallops River, which runs out of the national park on the Olympic Peninsula and down to through the national forest and down into the Puget Sound there, and the Hood Canal, actually. And so we put on wetsuits. There was a couple consultants, me and another fish, a wildlife guy from the department, and we snorkeled down the Dosey Wallops River, which had these huge boulders in it, At one point, and we had inner tubes, we had no helmets, and these guys wanted to go over this waterfall. So we did, and they all sat in their inner tubes, and I put mine out in front of mine, and the water slammed my back went like this.
Oh.
I was okay, but the next waterfall we came to, I said, we're going around. And you could walk barefoot in this old growth forest. It was just soft, you know, just no stickers, no blackberries. And so we made it all the way down, and we told them that Steelhead could pass up that river and they weren't gonna put their hydro on it. And so that was that. And then I went down to Vancouver, still with Washington Department of Wildlife, and became the called the regional wildlife biologist. So I was in charge of the wildlife program for the southwest region of the. I wasn't the head of the region. I was worked for that person, and we, you know, had Mount St. Helens in the area, and there was a big elk herd that, because the area was closed at Mount St. Helens when the hunting season came on, all the elk would run down into this area that was closed. And they were going to, Forest Service was going to open it. They got their national monument there, and they were going to open it to people coming. And so the department was looking at, well, opening in that area to special hunts, where somebody would have a tag just for getting one of the big bulls that were there. I mean, they were huge, huge antlers. And interestingly enough, so we held public meetings about that, and there had been a student at University of Washington who had radio tracked the elk that were coming and going from there, and she knew exactly where they were going. But the hunters did not want to hunt them. They said, no, we want to look at these elk. We want to have these elk. We know that they're there, and which was a total surprise to me, because I was proposing these hunting seasons. And so I asked the researcher that I knew to tell us where the elk, how they moved, because the hunters had a completely different idea where how they moved. But and we decided not to open any season in that area. So for to show that those elk now, if you drive that road up to Mount St. Helens Visitor Center, you'll often see them down in this one flat that they love to be in. So that was pretty interesting. And then the department had a budget crisis, and I was a junior. I was going to get my job, I was going to get bumped out of my job from somebody else losing their job. And so I just went and got a job at Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife in the Habitat Division. And I worked there for the rest of my career. I was working on watershed issues, and I eventually became the, I worked on in-stream water rights a lot, which were pretty controversial. Then I eventually became the division head of the Habitat Division, and that went on through about four or five different directors, and then I had great staff who were working on hydro issues, energy issues, land use issues, forestry issues, just kind of the whole gamut. We were working with all these other agencies to try to protect fish and wildlife habitat, or at least incorporate whatever plans people had into having some set aside or whatever, you know, for fish and wildlife. And then after, well, we adopted our daughter in 1995, and she was a newborn baby then. And I was still had Vineyard Winery, now a new baby, And my job is a division head. And I finally kind of got burned out from that in 2009.
No, that's when you retired.
No, yeah, 1999, right about when the new Carissa crashed out off of off of the coast off of Coos Bay. Yeah. And
well, what really burned you out, I think, was the legislative part of it. We don't need to go into details, but working with the legislature as a representative of the
Department of Fish and Wildlife. Department Although and Wildlife. I was backing off from that. But in the early days, I worked a lot informing the legislature, you know, showing them how these bills would affect fish and wildlife and that type of thing. So in 99, I had a half-time position in my division, and so I moved into it.
And to raise a child.
To be able to have half-time for a child who was in daycare and the winery. Mm-hmm. I figured that would help, and I was distributing wine, you know, on my off days and things like that. So, and that went on for another 10 years. And as soon as I could, I was working a lot more on water rights and also with vector control districts, which are interesting districts that aren't everywhere in the state, luckily, but they go around spraying for mosquitoes in areas where there's more problems, and they're spraying pesticides, and
we had to directly into water.
I had to learn all about pesticides. Mm-hmm. Well, not directly into water, over water.
Over water.
A lot
right.
of times, but so spraying malathion and other things like that. So I learned a lot about pesticides during that time, and then the state let you get out at 58 to retire. So as soon as I reached 58, I retired. And this became my full-time job, as well as the daughter.
Yeah.
Which...
the middle school and teenage years required a lot of attention.
Yeah, that was 2009 when I retired. So, it was obvious that, once child hits 13, they're a little different than when they were younger. But that's what I've been, managing the winery aspects, the distribution, the sales, and that type of thing. So
amazing. And Mark, tell us a little bit about your parallel career.
Well, I think I mentioned early on that I was doing some research for the University of Washington, studying old growth forests. That was back when we were just getting together, mm-hmm. and that eventually led to a job to work for the U.S. Forest Service's Research Station, and I continued to study. I'm more of like an ecologist, focusing on a variety of different things. But my passion in that position was the interplay between science and management, adapting scientific information and applying it to things on the ground. And so I worked very closely with kind of both branches, both the science branch and the management branch. And lo and behold, in 1994, was it? About 1994, about when where our first vintage was, the Northwest Forest Plan, which is kind of a legendary land management planning in among the natural resource agencies, where the Clinton administration came in and put this huge overlay on federal lands extending from the Washington border all the way down into Northern California to help conserve species that were rapidly disappearing. And I did a variety of different jobs with that, I was in charge of one of their science groups. They had these things called adaptive management areas where they would put a, attach a scientist to them to help managers to, rather than just going out and doing cutting or whatever they do in the forest, but also try to learn while you're doing it. So set up little experiments to understand them. So that was a really fun job. It was very interesting. And I worked primarily, I spent a lot of time down the Umpqua, in and out of Roseburg, and so I got to know that culture down there, down in the Umpqua National Forest. And then I also helped the National Forests set up a long-term bird monitoring among 10 national forests looking at neotropical migratory birds. And then I helped them on the science end of that and analyzing the data and training staff to go out and sample birds. Then I kind of made a bit of a career shift. There was kind of a new aspect of the Northwest Forest Plan that was getting underway, and that was looking at coming up with management strategies for rare species. So I ended up being the conservation biologist for the rare species part of the Northwest Forest Plan. And that was a crazy job. That involved understanding, collecting information on, and understanding that information on over 400 species spread out through that whole area of, I guess, probably 15 or 20 million acres. And it only took about 3 years to burn out on that job. And eventually, it was fascinating, but it was hard, and I ended up looking at working for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and helping out on a lot of their science issues, and also helping them out on overseeing monitoring of one of their endangered species, and then I finished up the last 15, 16 years with the National Park Service, and kind of did a full circle because all my early work, I did some work in Glacier National Park during my kind of early research days, and I did some master's work in the Great Smokies working on European wild boar, and then came up to the Northwest here and studied fires in Olympic and North Cascades and Mount Rainier National Parks. And then I kind of walked away from the Park Service because they didn't really have a very strong science component. So the Forest Service had a much more opportunities to be involved in ecological science. And then later on, Congress set aside some money for the parks to begin long-term ecological monitoring. And that's when I hooked up with the last 15, 16 years of my career with them. And that was a very interesting time and adventure to be working and helping out the parks, because these are our national treasures, and it's a humbling and honorable experience to help advance that, our knowledge gain that society wants to know, to make sure these parks are being kept into the best we possibly can, managing them into the future. And I retired from that 2 years ago. I don't know how we got all of the wine and the vineyard done in that journey.
And the child.
I just can't. Yeah. I look back on it, I'm going like, that is just, who would design something like that?
Yeah, we both just go, how did we get all that done?
So it probably leads to a kind of a question like, well, how did we survive? Well, it's through kind of humor, patience, passions that we had together.
Partnership.
Wine. Enjoying wine and food, so yeah.
In partnership,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what comes next for you two now?
Well, we're getting up there in years. There is no succession plan because the daughter is, you never know. I mean, it could change, but I think actually considering her knowledge base and personality, for her to inherit this, all these headaches probably wouldn't be the best idea. I think her life would be a lot simpler if she didn't really move in that direction.
She's more on the artistic side.
Yeah, more on the artistic than, and it requires.
She said she'd hire a manager.
Yeah, you're gonna need deep pockets for that.
She has some common sense.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, I mean, we'll take it at a year at a time. Obviously, you can't do it forever. You've interviewed a lot of people who have already, said that I've passed my prime, and not necessarily from a wine perspective, but just sort of can the body sustain this? The pressures of not only what Mother Nature throws at you every year in terms of trying to grow the grapes, but the challenges of winemaking, and then the challenges of dealing with the business side of it, of the marketing and distribution, and that just sort of that changing landscape. At some point, you just go, I'm exhausted. And we're not there yet, but one of these days we will be.
No, we want to travel more, and grapes are 9 months of the year.
And then
you sell them in the fall, that's where a lot of people buy wine. And
I'd say grapes are actually 10 months of the year.
10 months, yeah.
Yeah, it's really November and December. Oh, and then the winemaking part of it, you have to deal with it after you harvest it.
Yeah. I'm just talking about the vineyard is 9 months.
Yeah.
Then the winemaking is ongoing during that time, but then it gets intense for the next 2 months after you're
there isn't much downtime.
Touching the vineyard.
Yeah. We have this very select windows, like when we can go do something. Oh, maybe late December, early January before pruning season kicks in. I'm very passionate about the pruning in winter. I've always pruned at all our vineyards, and we have over 20,000 vines. So you kind of do the math. I've probably pruned over 500,000 vines over the years. I just have some friends now that come out and help, but over the early years, I used to do all the pruning. And that's kind of, where the wine's made. And you start the vintage in January. You're making decisions about the balance of the grapes from the year before, and you look at how the vines did. And of course, with a high density, it's really hard to train other people, vineyard workers, for that balance pruning, to be able to look at the past, the present, the future. All those things are surrounding you, just looking at a cane and the last year's growth, and how many buds you want to leave for the future, especially when there's a lot of competition going on between vines, and learning what that sweet spot is, the amount of the buds to leave.
So he would do the cuts,
make
the decisions. Then when we had workers, they would come through, pull the brush, and position the vine, tie the vines, and things like that. So now we do.
do all of it. But that was quite a journey with a full-time job, because it started in January. I'd only have weekends, and I'd get to about, you have to be done by about March, the third week of March, and I'd go, I'm going to have to use some of my vacation time to get it done again this year.
Yeah.
It was always a struggle to finish up in March. Whether it was snowing, raining with a Pineapple Express, it was the weekend time. That was the only time I could go out there. So
he could go out there anytime now.
I can go out there anytime now. It's great.
But we did learn that, mountaineering clothes are what you need in the winter time. The big boots that they use in Alaska and things like that.
Yeah. Well, and actually, working in kind of that early day exposure to working on the Olympic Peninsula, which they get 150 inches of rainfall a year out there.
Right.
Going out here in this winter rain out here, it's nothing compared to the Olympic Peninsula. It's a drizzle, even though people are going, wow, it's pouring.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, then the last question I have for you then is, you mentioned you don't predict the future, and that's fair, but from what you've talked about, some of the changes you've seen in the Oregon wine industry. So as you look ahead for the industry, what do you maybe hope happens next? Or are there things you're sort of fearful of as you look ahead for Oregon's wine industry?
You can have that question.
I think that our hope is that it keeps kind of the collegial atmosphere that it has, as opposed to getting into more, fighting amongst ourselves, or trying to outcompete. I know in the Yamhill-Carlton area, and what I've seen in some of the other areas, and you know, having the Willamette Valley Winery Association, having the sub AVAs, where the groups in each AVA are working together. You know, we've in Yamhill Carlton, we've had these tastings where, you know, we just had one in Bend, and in all pretty much almost all the owners were doing the tasting. Ken Wright, you know, whoever was there, they were owners, and they weren't all just the small wineries. Mm-hmm. And so if the industry can keep that, I think it'll really be a benefit to the industry. Obviously, the Oregon is now a international name, which is great for selling the wine, for sure, and having visitors come. We've had a lot more people visiting, even in the wintertime, who, you know, coming from Texas or the South or Florida or something like that. So I think that it's become a destination. You know, it's not at the category of California, but we can, you know, if we can keep kind of the interspersed agriculture that we have in Yamhill County. I mean, if you go to the Dundee Hills, it's kind of almost like California. There's vines almost everywhere. But in the rest of the Willamette Valley, it's a lot more interspersed agriculture, which I think helps people, you know, it's a lot more interesting to see. And so far, the valley floor isn't good for grapes, so it may be.
So far, until some giant corporation comes in and says, oh, we're going to live on Oregon's reputation and start growing them here in the flats and get 20 tons to the acre.
Yeah, well, and that may happen, although, you know, there's water issues here, so I don't, there, you know, there's not abundant water available. You'd have to go buy it from somebody else. And it's pretty already maxed out for the whole growing season everywhere in Oregon. There's, you know, even though the Willamette has dams, there's a lot of that water that's allocated to fish. So that's not going to go away for a long time. But I think, you know, I think that the corporations can move in and hopefully pick up on the culture here and not make the culture very different.
Well, Oregon is very fortunate to have a 40 or to 50 year experiment with land use laws that have helped retain land, make it available for the long term for agriculture to thrive, and hopefully that continues to kind of pass the test of time. I'm sure there'll be more attacks on it as time goes on and tweaking. I mean, always that needs a little bit of tweaking but I think a lot of the early day grumbling about why I couldn't build on this piece of property, most of that has kind of been settled ground through a few
measures
over the years. You know, some give and take between the environmental groups and the folk and the farmers who want to develop their land. And hopefully we're on the right road for the future. That would be good. I you know, there really is no other state in the United States that has a land use like we have here, and that's and the Oregon wine industry is very fortunate because that keeps some of these smaller lots still available, although, you know, they're getting pricey, but still, you know, somebody can get into the business and have a, you know, a 20 acre or 30 acre or 40 acre piece of land that it would be available for growing grapes on. And there's a lot of land out there that are just potential that can grow grapes. I mean, I was just driving down to Eugene yesterday and I stopped and saw a colleague up off of south of Monmouth, and that whole countryside there to the west of 99. There's like thousands of acres that could be planted in there. Really, it's just stunning, and it's really good land. So, I mean, Oregon has a long, long future ahead of us of potential growth. It's not like Bordeaux or Burgundy, where there's a line in the sand and you can't get any bigger. Oregon is not like that at all, and it's still growing AVAs every year. You know, every year you hear about, well, there's another AVA. You know, like the newest one is, I think, was Long Tom something.
Mount Pisgah.
Yeah, Mount Pisgah. And we'll be hearing more of that in the future as we discover more kind of what I'll call niches, ecological niches, where unique grapes or soils can grow. And I think climate change will probably provide even more places at higher elevations that we didn't even consider 30 or 40 years ago. Mm-hmm. But certainly climate change, as you know, you want to get into the kind of the future, that's a whole other topic. We can look to places in the world where climate change is much more accelerated in grape growing regions than we are here. We've actually been pretty buffered by it compared to other places. But if you look to those places and go, well, we could be like that in 10 or 15 years, it could be a little scary. Mm-hmm. How long can a very climate sensitive grape like Pinot Noir endure longer seasons where you'd be forced to bring the grapes in when it's still really hot? It's very clear to us that that the beauty of Pinot Noir is you want to be able to harvest it when we have cool nights. Cool nights, it really brings on some flavor components. And we harvest, we don't use any equipment in terms of measuring sugar, pH, or anything. It's all by flavor. We go out and taste the grapes on a daily basis and bring them in and go, oh, that, you know, the flavor of that juice isn't quite right yet. And so what happens with climate change affecting that is it's gonna bring the season in. We're gonna have more and more harvests earlier in September. And they're seeing this in Burgundy already. And what's driving that then is that the sugars are moving so fast that you, to even make something that's balanced, you've got to bring them in. But the flavors aren't developing at the same rate. And Pinot Noir needs to have that sugars and the flavor development on the same page to make a really very high quality wine. And so there's going to have to be a lot of experimental things to see how can we push back on climate change to be able to make the harvests back on where they should be naturally occurring. I don't know what needs to be done. Change rootstocks that ripen later, heavier crop loads maybe. Maybe smaller canopies. There's just a whole host of things that
our friends
virus causes. You know, the sugars to be a little lower. Mm-hmm. The folks down at OSU have got a zillion potential research projects that they can help us out in terms of what we call adapting to climate change. And I think that's one of the biggest issues in the future that the industry is going to be facing is, you know, how do we retain what has made Oregon, Oregon, or I shouldn't say Oregon, Oregon, but at least the Willamette Valley, how do you keep that in play at the quality level that we currently have when they're projecting, you know, a couple degrees increase in temperature over time, and there's a whole host of things that cause, you know, dryness, change in seasons, so on and so forth, freezes early on like we had this year. It's just, the list goes on, you know. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, that's all the questions that I have for the
right.
You. Is there anything I didn't ask that I should have? Anything that we didn't cover that you'd like to cover?
Didn't we already talk a lot?
You did, yeah.
No questions.
All right.
We rest our case.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, thank you both so much
for
your time and your stories and your hospitality out here today. And thanks for being part of our project, and we'll let you off the hook.
All right.
Thank you.